Les voy a presentar al profesor Darío Páez, catedrático de Psicología Social de la Universidad del País Vasco, que va a hacer la presentación del profesor Bernard Rimé.
Es una persona que ha publicado más de 100 artículos científicos y justamente lo que Bernard les va a presentar es una serie de estudios que demuestran que en contra del sentido común y de la cultura occidental, hablar sobre las emociones ni disminuye la rumiación o el darle vueltas a ellas, ni permite la recuperación emocional. Y sin embargo, va a permitir sobre todo la integración social.
Today I'm going to talk about the social sharing of emotion. All in all, you can observe the social sharing of emotion in 80 to 100% of all emotional episodes. There is a strong correlation between the intensity of the emotion and the extent to which this emotion would be talked about. So, the more intense the emotion, the more it will be socially shared. Couple of examples of empirical data demonstrating the reality of the social sharing of emotion. Psychology students from my department who in their first year were confronted to their most important exam, the first time they got a university exam. And you can see that after 1 week, all of them did speak about the exam. After 2 weeks, still important sharing. After 3 weeks, we can see the extinction developing. Question. Why do people want to share their emotions? Why do they do so? So we have answers which vary according to the type of emotion. When it comes to positive emotions, the answer is very easy. Telling a positive emotion, it's a positive thing, of course. And it was established already a long time ago by Langston that telling a positive emotion involves a process of capitalization. Every time you would exploit this capital by telling about the story to someone else, you would get interest or benefits. And what the benefits are, it's an enhancement of your positive affectivity. It was demonstrated that not only the person who is doing so, but also the listener. And for instance, in couples, if in the couple the partner is playing the game, listening to the story and reacting positively, then it's not only the sender but also the couple as an interpersonal relationship which gets improved. And you have data showing that couples who are sharing positive emotional experience have a higher level of intimacy, a higher level of couple satisfaction and the like. So it's positive not only for yourself but for your relatives or couple relationship. When you share a negative emotion, you do not get an enhancement of your positive affects, but of course you get an enhancement of your negative affects. The majority among us would answer that talking about an emotion, negative emotion, would bring you emotional recovery. It would bring you sort of a catharsis, a discharge, a relief, and so on. I'm telling you this because we have been investigating this question in various countries in the world, and we always find that in all the countries, a vast majority of people support this idea. Here is a representation of the prediction. The black line here in dots is representing the normal extinction of an emotional experience across time. The more time passes, the less this emotional experience will impact upon the person, except if it's a trauma, of course. If it's a trauma, it's not true. But for regular emotion, this is what happens. If you have, at some point, an expression of emotion, then you should accelerate the decline. You should accelerate the extinction process, and because you would have the emotion vanishing. And I'm representing this boiling stuff here, because it's the boiling metaphor which lies behind. The idea that a person who is in an emotional state is a person who, in some sense, is boiling inside. And so when you have this metaphor in your mind, if you just remove the upper part of the boiler, then you let the steam off. This is like expressing yourself. And once you get the steam off, there is less pressure in the reservoir. Three examples of studies we have been developing. The first example, which is very simple, we could collect among people emotional episodes which they never talked about, that they simply kept secret. And we observed that the emotional impact is exactly the same whether the person has been speaking about it or whether the person kept the episode secret. Another type of studies was what we call correlative studies, which consist of observing naturally, once an emotional episode happens, how often each person talks about it. and then observing a little later the emotional impact that this emotion is keeping for this person, and examining the relationship between the two variables. Studies after studies, we were totally unable to predict the degree of emotional impact or emotional recovery by taking the extent of social sharing as a predictor. And a third type of study, it's laboratory experimental studies of the social sharing, which consisted of inducing the social sharing of emotion in the laboratory. For instance, by having participants coming individually and having them invited to talk to an experimenter about a given important past episode of this person. And in all these experiments, we never registered an impact of this induced social sharing upon emotional recovery. So again, negative conclusion. When I was a student in the first years of my career, no psychologist whatsoever would never have been called upon a situation where a drama would have occurred or where victim would be. And in recent years, there's been a spread of this practice, social practice, which makes that as soon as there is a catastrophe somewhere, psychologists are sent and psychologists take care of the people. And what psychologists do is, in part, also conduct psychological debriefing. Debriefing consists of taking the victims, gathering them together by groups of, say, 10 to 15 persons, and having them to talk extensively about the experience they made in the catastrophic situation. For instance, to give you an idea of the positive views of participants, they told that managers of the debriefing situation played very important symbolic social function with respect to victims, because they represent the society. They offer listening, understanding, and support. They validate something which everybody who was a victim experiences like it's unbelievable. Huh? And how do you go after that in the society with an unbelievable experience to share with others? You can't, except if you are validated. And those guys are validating. So it brings social integration of the victims. And also, at this situation, you meet peers. There are other victims with you. And with those ones, you can initiate a very important social process. There is mutual listening. There is mutual support. There is reciprocal empathy. And this could be very important for the future of these people. We can conclude that mere emotional expression in an interpersonal context, like sharing situation or like psychological debriefing, brings no emotional recovery, but seem to bring very important benefits for a number of social variables. What is involved in an emotional experience? And I first start with a graph here, which I have the ambition to propose as a quick summary of what we all do during our entire life. You will experience here something that we call sadness, that we call fear, that we call anger, that we call shame, which could vary according to the circumstances. So a whole lot of negative emotion. Because you cannot reach your goal anymore, there is something which now disconfirms your theories, your models, your representation, your expectation. You did not predict correctly. So there was something wrong in your theory, in your models. Some circumstances could be slight things. If this is a traumatic situation, everything there could be destroyed. And that's the basis of the post-traumatic stress syndrome. And so this means that when you leave an emotional situation, you leave it with a feeling that you need new meanings, that you have got a loss of meaning. Let me tell you very quickly the story of experiments we conducted with our students in my university. We invited undergraduate students to take part in an experiment, and we didn't tell them what the experiment would be. And the day they were expected to come, we told them as a group, okay, now, you will be given an envelope containing questionnaire. The envelope is sealed. You cannot open the envelope. And now, you will take this envelope in your life, and you will expect during the next 7 days that something of an emotion would occur to you. And once you get this emotion, immediately after, please open the envelope and try to complete our questionnaires. And we told them it doesn't need to be very important emotion. As soon as you feel yourself emotional, open the envelope. That's the thing you need to pay attention to. Open the envelope, complete the questionnaire. But everybody, in a period of 1 week, at an emotion of enough importance to be the motive to open the sealed envelope. Now, we separated our students into three conditions. Part of them had to pay attention to a positive emotional episode, another part to negative emotional episode, and then we had a third group, which was a control group, to whom we did tell not to expect an emotional episode, but something which is unusual and which would happen in their life without being particularly emotional. When you go through any negative emotion, you would get a very strong feeling of being lonely. This is something that we've been checking in many, many studies. Negative emotion, feeling of loneliness. Loss of motivation, discouragement, helplessness, and loss of control. Impact one, a goal cannot be reached. This is a source of emotional experience, sadness, fear, anger, and shame. But then there is a second thing, which in my view is totally independent of the first one. It results from the fact that your cognitive models were disconfirmed and your self-confidence was shattered, and this is the source of a state of emotional distress through which you are going to experience feelings of anxiety, uncertainty, helplessness, and so on and so on. It's another experience, it's a different thing, and it required another processing, another treatment. So we are faced now with two tasks after an emotion. So let me summarize briefly what the two tasks are. On the one hand, they are the cognitive task. Your cognitive task involves that if you want to go through the emotional experience, you need to revise your goals. You could not reach the goal, you have to change your hierarchy of goals and change your perspectives in life. Then you have to modify and adapt your theories, your models, which were wrong in this situation. Second task, it's socio-affective task. There, you need, if you want to go through the emotional distress, you need to receive what? Exactly the type of things that your mother was giving to you when you were a small baby in a distressing state. It's exactly the same process. It's perpetuation of attachment behavior. So it means receiving comfort, receiving support, validation, recognition, social integration, esteem, and so on and so on. And then you would get rid of the emotional distress and you would be able to start being in the world again as a strong person. So that's going to bring you not recovery, but emotional relief. When a person is listening to the social sharing of an emotion by someone else, you can check the emotions that this person is going to experience. And you have all types of values for the various emotions, which vary with the type of episodes which was heard. But there is one thing which is peeking out of the data, is the result for the emotion of interest. That's on 7-point scales. And you can see that interest is virtually at the top of the scale, which means that listening to the emotion of another person is something that we do quite willingly. We find this interesting. Another observation that you can make upon the listeners is, what do they do? How do they respond to the social sharing? And here we have been grouping together two types of responses. On the one hand, verbal manifestation, talking to the other person. On the other hand, non-verbal manifestation, such as touching the other person, watching the other person into the end, the eyes, coming close to this person, some cases taking the person into the arms, giving a kiss to the person, things like that, non-verbal behavior. And these behaviors do vary with the intensity of the emotion. So that's interesting. In intense emotional situation, people reduce their talking and they enhance their nonverbal behavior, touching, coming close, giving a kiss, and so forth and so on. We have on the left side a person A who has been experiencing a negative emotion and who is in need to share this emotion. So this person is going to express emotion to a target person B who is going to be the quite willing listeners. This listener is going to feel understanding and willingness to help the other person. And so the other person is going to receive understanding, help, support, and so on and so on. When you received such gift, such social gift, then it brings obvious conclusion. You would like the person B more. And on the other hand, there are many data in social psychology showing that when you develop yourself pro-social behaviors, you start liking the persons to whom you develop these pro-social behaviors, which bring that the net result of such an interaction is that these two persons come closer to one another. They improve their social integration. There is also what I'm calling here the secondary social sharing. It's the result of a very simple syllogism. If emotions are socially shared, which I tried to show you in my first slide of the presentation, and if targets experience emotion when listening, if listeners do experience emotion at listening, then there is a conclusion. Targets should share what they heard with third persons. So they should leave the primary sharing situation and go to a secondary sharing situation where they told to third person what they heard. Is there evidence of a tertiary social sharing? You can figure out that the person who has been the secondary sharing listener, this person also experiences emotion and then would go to a third person D, to a fourth person D, in a tertiary social sharing. Here is the result of this situation. That's you with your negative emotional episode that you wanted to share. On average, if it's an episode of some intensity, you would share it with 3, 4, 5 persons of your first circle of relationship. Each of these persons is going to tell 1, 2, 3, if it's a very important episode, 4 and sometimes more persons, to a second circle. Each person in this second circle is going to repeat the story to the third circle. And all in all, in my estimation here, we have 50 to 60 persons, and this develops in usually less than one day. This means that your social environment, your regular social networks, your friends and the friends of your friends, all know what happened to you. They know that it's to you, because don't think that they would fail to mention your name. If they don't mention your name, nobody would believe them. So they need to mention the name to give validity and reality to the process. Benefits for the social sharing and its diffusion. Many benefits, socially speaking. For the one who initiates, he or she gets social recognition, validation, support, and people around them will know what happened. For the community, very important process, because the emotional information is distributed. The social knowledge about emotion is extended. We have a new instance of what can happen to you. We were stimulated by a study which was published a couple of years ago by Stephen Lepore, Pablo Fernandez Berrocal, and their colleagues Ragan and Ramos, published in 2004, in which they had participants viewing an emotional movie to induce an emotion. And immediately after the movie, they were assigned to 4 different conditions. Some of them had to face a challenging confederate, which would be going to push them in reframing or reappraising the movie situation to which they were exposed. So reappraising, reframing the emotional episode, or a validating, supportive confederate, or a situation in which they would be asked to talk alone in front of a microphone, and finally a control situation with no talk. And this study was giving a very interesting situation, very, very interesting result, because this study was for once demonstrating an emotional recovery effect. And the emotional recovery effect happened in the first condition, the challenging confederate, where there was reframing, reappraising, which is exactly, in our view, a cognitive task which was fulfilled in this situation. We also induced an emotion using a movie clip. It was a clip with human beings acting in a nasty manner with regard to animals, so it was really something ugly and emotional. And then we started the social sharing process, but this time with an intimate partner, because something I didn't insist upon, but which is very important, emotional sharing usually in current life develops with intimate persons. So we thought we would really improve the situation, and we asked any participant to come to the laboratory with a best friend and to have this best friend playing the role of the listener. So the participant would see the movie and the best friend would be in a waiting room situation in the meantime. When the intimate partner, the listener, the guy in the waiting room situation was in this waiting room situation, the experimenter came to this person and gave this person instruction. three different types of instruction. For some of them, we told them to just listen to sharing after the movie in a neutral manner, without intervention. And then we had the situation of empathetic sharing, where the socio-affective mode had to be developed. And finally, we had a situation of positive reframing. With a few instructions, we suggested the guy who was going to play the role of a confederate to develop a cognitive mode of responding. And you can see that there is only one condition in which the emotional responding is very low. It's in the cognitive situation. In our group, it was the very first time that we observed an effect of recovery after a social sharing situation. This means that if you instill cognitive activities in the social sharing, you can bring emotional recovery, as was already demonstrated by the study I mentioned before. What regards the cognitive reconstruction, you can see that only in the cognitive situation where the cognition at high rate, which means that people had been reconstructing their views of human being, whereas the two other groups were low and were at the same level, and that was stable even after re-exposure to movie. The only condition in which the person doesn't feel lonely is the green one, is the socio-affective one, and it's very stable. In the other two conditions, people feel lonely, and of course you would feel lonely if you just watch it, a nasty situation, and you tell to someone to whom you expect, from whom you expect some supporting reaction, and this person is staying either neutral or acts in a cognitive manner. That's going to bring a strong feeling of loneliness, of being abandoned by the person we share. Probably the best thing we can do in practice is to use a correct combination of these two things, and maybe the timing is extremely important. Maybe it's useful to think that we should start using this at first for some time to get the person in a better general emotional state, and then go to the cognitive mode a little bit after. I'm often suggesting that maybe every form of psychotherapy is using this type of tools in combination, that even if you take the psychoanalytic classic situation, when they talk about interpretation by the psychoanalyst, in my view, they do this, cognitive mode, and it's reframing, reappraising. And when they talk about the transference, in my view, this is exactly the socio-affective mode. So maybe we have something which reflects the general rules of psychotherapeutic practice. I'm thanking you for your attention and wish you good appetite.